Welcome to Public Health On Call, a new podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. Our focus is the novel coronavirus. I'm Josh Sharfstein, a faculty member at Johns Hopkins and also a former secretary of Maryland's Health Department. Our goal with this podcast is to bring evidence and experts to help you understand today's news about the novel coronavirus and what it means for tomorrow. If you have questions, you can email them to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes. Today, Stephanie Desmon talks to Professor Jeffrey Kahn, a bioethicist at Johns Hopkins, who is the lead author of a new report about the use of digital contact tracing using smartphones to help stem the spread of COVID-19. They discuss the pros and cons and the privacy questions of using technology for this type of public health detective work. Let's listen.
Jeff Kahn, thank you so much for joining me.
My pleasure. Thanks for having me.
So I'd like to start with a simple question. If we could sort of define contact tracing in light of COVID and generally.
Sure. So it's what it sounds like. It's identifying people who have been exposed. So you need to know who was infected to know who's been exposed. And then finding those who have been in contact with somebody who's known to be infected, tracing them and then all the people that they might have exposed in the time that they have been infected. So it's a sort of think of it as a web of infection and identifying those who are infected and the cases and then those who they have infected and those who they have infected have infected and so on. Quite complicated in the case of a respiratory infection because of the way it's spread.
And this is typically done manually, right? I mean, you tell people who you've seen, they call them up.
Traditionally, it's done, right, human-powered or manually. Traditional, we have to make up new terms for this because we hadn't had the alternative until now, which is, you know, we're calling digital or technology aided. So you're right. When it was known that there was an infectious disease in a community, you find out who's been infected and you literally contact tracers would call them up or go to those people's homes or offices and ask them all sorts of questions. Of course, the questions depend on how the particular disease is spread. And so questions about a respiratory illness are different than one that is foodborne or sexually transmitted.
So talk to me about making this digital, how it works or how it could work and what you see as perhaps some of the pros and cons of it.
Yeah, and I think it's important to say it the way you just said, which is how it could work, because we are really in uncharted and untried territory here where we don't know how it will work because it's really being tried for the first time in other parts of the world and I think soon will be implemented in parts of this country. But certainly we don't know how it will work yet. So the idea is to take advantage of the fact that we all walk around with devices that are mostly on our body or very close to our bodies, right? And in the form of a smartphone, a mobile device that has all sorts of technology in it that will allow us to know who we have been in proximity to. So our phones know when they're in proximity to other phones. And the sort of earliest implementation is something called proximity notification. So it's really not contact tracing. It's a alert that your phone would get that it had been in proximity to another phone of a person who's known to have been infected or exposed to someone who's infected. And it would alert the individual it would alert the phone and the phone would, you know, ping the individual to say you may have been exposed. And then the individual could do something with that information. They could go seek testing. They could inform public health. They could do nothing. It would be up to them. So that's sort of a first stage kind of the way technology would work. It could be more sort of sophisticated in the sense that the information about an exposure could be shared, not just with the individual through the phone, their phone notifying them, but that information could be shared with public health authorities or the government or employers or institutions like universities. But that's a sort of an additional layer of technology. And the discussion now is about sort of what to implement and what to mandate or require or allow people to opt into or require people to opt out of. And so it's a complicated layering of technologies that are digital that would aid, and it's important to say this, aid the traditional human-powered contact tracing efforts, not to replace it. No one thinks, I think, that it could replace it. It doesn't make sense to even pose that.
I think that if I got a notification, you may have been exposed to COVID on my phone, that would really frighten me. It doesn't give me a lot of context. It doesn't, so I passed somebody in the store, but did I talk to that person? Did I spend time with them? Is there a way to give more information than that?
It's a good question. And so the idea of exposure notification is that your phone was within a set distance, 3 feet is the number that's being used, but it could be even as little as 1 foot, proximity to another phone for a set period of time. So it's both proximity and time of exposure or, being nearby. And then when somebody is known to be infected, the other phones that have been near that phone for an extended period of time are pinged. So all you're getting is information that you may have been exposed. As you said, the technology isn't smart enough, if that's the right way to say it, to know, well, wait a second, maybe I was on the other side of a wall of that phone. Maybe I wasn't actually in proximity in the sense that will matter. As you say, well, was I wearing a mask? Was the other person wearing a mask? What were we doing? Were we in a bar together? That's a different kind of exposure probably, because we might have been talking in that sense, there's aerosol versus standing in line at a grocery store. Very different. And there's no way that the technology can answer that question. And so it probably would be more than just you've been exposed, alert, alert. It would be, you may have been exposed. Here's what you should do next, or here's what you can do next, which would be things like seek testing. Your state allows you to make an appointment for testing without symptoms, or your state allows you to go to walk in for testing. It will be different in different places. Or here's the number of a public health authority that will help you, with next steps. There's all sorts of possible answers to your question, and that will be different in different places as implementation begins.
I have a friend in Singapore who, every time she goes into a store, she has to basically register that she was there and give them her ID number. And I'm sure that's linked to her phone. But it seems like Singapore and privacy is not necessarily something we think about together. So, but in the United States, we're all about our personal privacy. So talk to me about sort of the ethical considerations here.
Yeah, that's a really good point. And the places where this has been most fully implemented are places where privacy and other civil liberties, that would be the general category I would use, sort of have a different place in this society than they would here in the United States. So you're right to focus on that. That said, we do care a lot about privacy in our country, but we also, I think, at this point are realizing there are other values at stake than our privacy, which are about getting us out of our sheltering in place. Even as we move from stage one to stage two, we're still very restricted in our movements, getting back to work, sending our children back to school, having universities open and students and faculty and staff back on campuses. All of those are values too that matter. And, especially when people can't work from home, there's a very strong value in being able to earn an income and feed your family and pay for your rent. So yes, privacy, but privacy is not the only value that matters. And I think it's an unusual time. That doesn't capture it even in the least, really. It's such an unusual time that I think, it's important to sort of step back and say, how do we balance all of the values that matter in the context of helping to work our way through the coming weeks and months until there's a vaccine and we can really, beat this virus. And so, yes, privacy matters, but how much is a really important question, and how to balance the value of privacy against the other really important values.
It's a really good point. Another question I was thinking about was sort of the equity issue here. Not everybody has a digital has a smartphone. So how would this help those folks? Or obviously it won't work with those folks. How do we cross this digital divide?
Yes, it's a good question. And, you know, the answers could be everything from let's get everybody smartphones, you know, so that these technologies are available to everybody. But that's not likely, I think, to be implemented. But we could say we need to focus the human-powered contact tracing efforts in the parts of a community that just don't have access to these digital technologies, so that there's equitable access to the benefits of contact tracing and helping to tamp down outbreak, right? So there's a way to say, well, it's all about tamping down outbreak and beating the virus. And so technology will be more available in some parts of a community than others, but we can still make sure that the overall goals of contact tracing are equitably shared across a community by putting more human powered in some areas and maybe less in others where there's more technology to be brought to bear. So I think there are ways to make that less of an issue.
And I was also just thinking about how we're not really enamored at the moment of our tech companies, right? There's a lot of feeling that they are not serving our best interests. And now we're about to say, and, you know, if we were to go forward with this, now we're about to say, we're going to give you even more data about ourselves. How likely are we going to want to opt into something like this? I guess maybe it has to do with how you frame it when you're pitching this to folks.
Yes. So it's a really good point. And listeners may know that Apple and Google, in an unprecedented decision, are working together to make the internal workings of the operating systems on their phones, or on phones that run their operating systems, accessible. It's called the API. And they have coordinated access to the API of both the OS on Apple and Android so that apps will work on either kinds of phone in a consistent way. And they have done that with strong limitations in place, which are privacy protecting. So they have really put privacy first. Interestingly, and I do ethics for a living, so I care a lot about privacy and other civil liberties. The report that is prompting our conversation says, you know, maybe the Apple, Google limitations are too strict. They may not actually help achieve the public health goals because they are so privacy protecting that they don't permit certain kinds of sharing with public health authorities. And so it may, in fact, there's an argument happening, an argument's a little strong, a discussion happening in the world of, you know, people who are paying attention to these technologies, public health, civil liberties, and the tech companies about what the right balance is to be struck. And Apple, Google has actually sort of stayed pretty true to their commitment to protect privacy and say, but maybe other technologies can be added to the one that we're allowing to work on our phones to get the right combination. But we're not going to open our phones to more than these privacy-protecting apps. So really, there's a little convoluted answer to your question, but I think they're trying to figure out what the right balance is. And one thing to say is, you know, the tech company's interest, as you said before, may not be exactly aligned with the public's interest when it comes to public health, or just generally. And so how do we balance all of that when they are pretty much in a position to dictate terms because they control the operating system of every phone on the planet? So it needs to be a coordinated effort. And I think there's goodwill and work happening among legislators and tech companies and public health officials and a little bit of people like me to try to get it right.
Jeff Kahn, thank you so much for joining me.
It's been my pleasure. Thanks for having me.
Thank you for listening to Public Health on Call, a new podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. Please send questions to be covered in future podcasts to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. This podcast is produced by Josh Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Lamare Morales. Audio production by Niall Owen McCusker and Spencer Greer, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Thank you for listening.